Hey BookTube, it's Kim at Middle of the Book March, and this is my first video where I get to present to you the books that I read and judged for the BookTube Prize. This is actually my second time judging, but in 2019, the inaugural year, which I took part, I didn't have a BookTube channel yet. I was simply a BookTube lurker. So now I have a channel and I wanted to share my results with you. I read and judged the fiction books in Group G. And as you saw on the slide in the beginning of my video, those were the books that I read. So let me tell you what the results were. I'm going to show you and talk about the books from 6 to 1. So from least liked to most liked. And here's number 6. Mexican Gothic by Silvia Moreno Garcia. This was a big, huge disappointment for me. I actually started reading it last year and DNF'd it. And then once I realized it was in my fiction group, I brought it back and revisited it and was, again, just disappointed. I have to admit to skim reading much of it. But this is the story of Noemi, who comes from a wealthy, privileged, glamorous, kind of a Latinx family, and she is kind of tasked with helping her cousin, who is kind of frantic and anxious and terrified that her husband is trying to kill her. So Noemi is charged with going to see if her cousin, what's going on and if she can help, and trying to figure out what is all happening. I don't want to give too much away because it is a gothic mystery kind of a book. That's why it's titled Mexican Gothic. But for me, it's more on the gothic supernatural horror genre. I thought the writing was cliche and stereotypical. I did not enjoy the writing in the least. I could not care about these characters. I really did not like them. You know, I thought the story was silly and kind of gross and just uninteresting to me. A ton of people love this book, and that's great. This was not a book for me, and I never should have picked it up to begin with. But it just, when it first was coming out, it was one of those books I was looking forward to getting released. And I should have known better because it's just not my style of book, so I just did not enjoy it. Barn 8 is number 5. Barn 8 was written by Deb Olin Unferth, and I think this is her debut novel. I'll double check that. This was a weird book. This was about chicken auditors or egg auditors. I'm kind of looking over at my laptop. I have a few little notes here and there. Two auditors for the U.S. egg industry go rogue and conceive a plot to steal 1 million chickens in the middle of the night. This is a very strange plot, and it starts off with strange characters. It's a teenage girl that loses her mother, has to go live with the father that she never really interacted with. She ends up at a job at an egg plant, being an auditor. I don't know if it's a USDA auditor or something like that. But she and a woman who kind of has a connection to the family, they team up and they decide that they're going to steal this 1 million chickens and release them into the wild. And there's a lot of commentary on ecology and animal rights, vegetarianism, all of those things wrapped up together. But I kind of thought it was silly, and there was no purpose to the novel. I clearly did not enjoy it because it's number 5. But I mean, I didn't hate it, but I just thought this is kind of ludicrous in a weird way. The writing was okay, but it wasn't anything that I loved or I thought was fantastic or spectacular. It was just, it was a good concept, and I was interested in reading it before I was assigned it, but I did not enjoy it. Number 4 is Crooked Hallelujah by Kelly Jo Ford. And this novel is set in the 70s in the Cherokee Nation in Oklahoma. And I believe Kelly Jo Ford has Native American ancestry, and I will double check that. And if I'm wrong, I will put that in the bottom of the screen. But this is kind of a short family saga, and it starts off with Justine and her mother Lulu, and there's Granny is in there, and Justine eventually has a daughter Rennie. And it's basically discussing their interaction, the family history, very strange moves in the South and mid Southwest areas. I don't know. It was like, it was okay. There were bits of the writing that I was hopeful that were descriptive and good characterization. There was a lot of backtracking and back and forth, and it was easy to get the names of the characters confused as to which roles they played. There's a lot about living in poverty and settling for a specific life with a specific man. The book does have somewhat of a happy ending or a satisfying ending, but it was kind of twisty to get there, and I wasn't thrilled with the writing. I thought it was straightforward and not creative in the way that I respond to best. I don't know, I keep shrugging my shoulders because none of the bottom three books were that spectacular to me, and they probably won't ever stay with me for very long. I will remember that I read them, but these were not books that I really cared about, and I think that's why they're in the bottom three. It's funny because the description of the writing in this book is lush and descriptive, and I just did not believe that. It had its moments, it did, and there's redeeming qualities in the writing. And I really wanted to read a book written by a Native person about a Native American family. I was looking forward to that. But the interesting thing is, in the book, Justine is a Cherokee woman, but there's not a lot of discussion about Cherokee history or this family's experiences as a Native American family. You can kind of derive from where they live and how they live that is the case, but not all of the people in the family are Native American or Cherokee. They're white, and it just, I don't know, it didn't flow like I was hoping that it was going to. Number three, now here's my top three, is Pew by Catherine Lacey, and I actually have a hard copy of this one. This is a tiny little book, but look at how small it is compared to my head. Yeah, that looks a little more natural, but this is a really interesting book, and this is a naked hardback, and the blurb on the back, and then the description is printed on the inside front cover. That's the author's picture and bio, but it's really an interesting construction of the physical book, and I really liked that. This is my number three. This is a very interesting story. It's a town that is unnamed in the southern U.S., and the main character is unnamed and ungendered. This character, main character, is called Pew, because that's where they are found by a family in this southern church. And it says, a small unnamed town, a church congregation arrives for a service, and there is a figure asleep on a pew. And they give this person this nickname. They are young. It is not obvious if this person is a boy or a girl, and that's a very big discussion throughout the novel. This family takes them in, and they give them clothes and food and a place to sleep, and then they proceed, the family proceeds to shuffle them through one house after another. And it's a church community, so the church is banding together to help this person, to give them what they need and to try to find their history. They make a plan with, I think, the pastor, who wants to take this person to a doctor to find out their background and to find out what gender they are. So they realize that this person is young, so they're thinking it could be a teenager. And what they're trying to do is highly illegal, but this is a lot of commentary about Christianity and faith. What happens when this band of churchgoers gets together and has to try to agree on a course of action? That part of it to me was very comical, because I've been in church situations like that before. You never get anybody to agree. You never get a big consensus easily. Some really wacky ideas of what some of the church members wanted to do to get the answer of who this person is. They think maybe this was a young person who was kidnapped and just abandoned, or could be homeless or runaway, something of that sort. There's an interesting event that happens towards the end of the book, and that's where it got really weird. I don't think it would be that obvious of a commentary unless you had a church, an evangelical church background. I should specify that. So it did even got a little weird for me, and I do have a background in that. So I did enjoy the book. It was different, and I think that's the main thing that came out for me. The writing was interesting. The story was completely different than anything that I have been accustomed to, and I did enjoy this novel, so it ended up at number 3. The Prettiest Star by Carter Sickles is number 2. I really did like this book. This was very well written. It's the story of a young man who's 24 years old. His family, he's from Appalachia, and this is set in 1986. His name is Brian, and he has found out that he's dying of AIDS. And so he had a partner in New York City who died of AIDS, and he comes from a community of found family who so many gay men in that found group have died. And they don't have a grasp and a handle on the disease at this point in time, in this point in history. And Brian thinks that he's in danger. And once his partner has died, he knows he's next. And it's really interesting what type of background he's had and what he talks about as a character in the book. He's very transparent about the both of them, he and his partner, having free reign to do whatever they wanted back in the 80s and the late 70s. And it's such an interesting dynamic, because it's his parents, his younger sister, and his grandmother are the main family characters that come up in the novel. It's so sweet what happens with his grandmother. I'm going to try not to say too much, because if you read it, I want you to discover it on your own. And Brian, there's a lot of internal monologue from Brian and his observations and that kind of thing. This, I have to admit, this book did make me cry. I've been a gay man in the early 80s who was terrified by the scourge that was killing, at the time, mostly gay men. So there's a lot of really raw, interesting narrative about that. And just the family interaction and the family dynamics had me on the edge of my seat. I thought it was a beautiful book. Again, it's very raw, but in that, I think you can make beauty from that. And the end of the book was the best part, in my opinion. So that was number 2. Number 1 is Things in Jars by Jess Kidd. I also have this one as a physical book. And this was my number 1. Again, I went between this and The Prettiest Star, but this reading experience was so fun and propulsive, and I was dying to pick the book up again and find out what happens. It's somewhat of a mystery. So typically, if there's a mystery involved in a book, it's a fast read and it's fast paced. But I also love the writing in this book, and it's a very quirky, supernatural type of story. It's set in Victorian London, and Bridie Devine is a female detective/investigator The characters surrounding her are so quirky and interesting and fantastical. She's investigating a mystery of a child kidnapped from a wealthy doctor, and this is not a normal child. And at first it sounds like it's kind of a mermaid story, but it's quite a bit more than that. It's not really a mermaid story. There's a lot of themes of water and superpowers, and and there's a kidnapping, there's a lot of background dysfunction, there's a lot of mysterious characters, a very twisty story. There's a lot of narrative about Bridie's childhood, and she was actually an orphan on the streets, and she was brought in by a man who was basically a body snatcher and an early autopsy performer and organ snatcher, I guess, but a person who wanted to investigate those things, and she as a child was his assistant. So there's so many threads of story in this book. It's so interesting, and it was so fun to read, and Jess Kidd writes very well, so I was really happy to vote number one for Things in Jars. So that was it for my results for Group G in fiction. I am very happy to say that each of my top three books made it to the quarterfinals. Yay! So I found that out earlier today. I'm filming this on Tuesday. And so I'm really, really happy about that. It's going to be fun to find out what the next groupings are. I'm actually not involved in judging for the next round, so we'll see what happens for the semifinals. Let me know about any of the books that I showed you, if you've read them and what you thought. Let me know if your opinions are different than mine. I'm totally okay with disagreements. Be nice. And that's it for today. I hope you're having a good week, and I'll see you in the next video. Bye, everybody.